Okay, here we go.
Our founding fathers had a secret.
What was the secret?
A treasure.
Treasure hunting isn't something that was invented for movies and went out of style at some point. It's a big deal still today.
You're treasure hunters, aren't you?
We're more like treasure protectors.
It's the solving of the puzzle that drives a treasure hunter.
There's thousands of years of world history down there, and it belongs to the world.
I think what inspires me most about treasure hunting is bringing the history to life.
We're about 3 miles from that peak over there. It's not so much an obsession with the wealth, because that wealth may or may not happen, and more often than not, doesn't happen. But it is an obsession with the history.
It's got a glaze on the inside, and then on the outside, it's got some blue paint. It's full of romance and adventure and history.
That little flower pot.
It really becomes a way of life, and there's so much to learn.
We are currently mostly involved with the Atocha Margarita site, which is two sister ships that sank in 1622 off Key West, Florida. And we are also focused on the 1715 fleet, which was 11 ships that sank in a hurricane on the east coast of Florida.
We have research on over 1,000 Spanish galleons that sank in the Caribbean. That's very time-consuming just to do one and do it right. The archaeology is a very important part of it. When a coin is buried in the sand, it turns the sand black around it. It's a chemical reaction between the silver and the salt water that produces silver sulfide.
All right, look at that.
There's some good ones there.
Wow, the ones in the middle are going to be real nice.
We get an eye for whatever looks like it doesn't belong there. Even little bits of pottery or little bits of junk. God doesn't make straight edges and perfect circles.
Gold is impervious, nothing affects it. But everything else on these wrecks does deteriorate with time, and eventually there won't be anything left of it. So the sooner we can bring it up, the more there is to preserve for future generations to enjoy.
I got started treasure hunting when I was 11 years old in the Guadalupe Mountains of West Texas, and I was hooked, and I've been going ever since. We go after lost caches of treasure, often from bank robberies. The most recent adventure that we have involves a pack train of silver that was on its way down to Mexico City when it was attacked in the Sierra Madres. The men stashed the silver in a cave, and then in the process of fleeing, all were killed but two. The two that made it back to Mexico City logged it in a journal, and we found that journal. We spent 7 years trying to follow their path through the Sierra Madres, and we finally found it. One of our party was walking along the cliff face, and we heard him scream, and we thought he had been bitten by a rattlesnake. We ran over to where he was. We peered into the slit in the limestone wall, and when our eyes became accustomed to the darkness in the slit, we saw what had to have been hundreds of bars of silver that had been thrown into that crack. There were 888 bars of silver.
When you find it, that's just the beginning. Then the conservation work really starts.
Hello, Mel.
Hi, Mel.
My father was one of the pioneers in treasure hunting, and he made it possible for us all to continue on.
Mel started the Mel Fisher Maritime Heritage Society, and hopefully that'll be a repository forever that people can learn from the adventures and the recoveries that we've been doing all of our lifetime.
When we first started, the way the people cleaned stuff was they would dip it in acid, but in a few years it would start crumbling apart. So my father developed these conservation techniques, this reversed electrolysis that we use today, which cleans the artifacts. It takes a lot longer. A coin will take a couple of weeks, but when you're done, you have a piece that will last forever.
99.9% of the stuff that we find takes weeks, months, and sometimes years to go through the electrolytic process to preserve.
This is copper and lead sheeting from the shipwreck. And this is pottery. And that's an artifact of some sort. We don't know what yet. Every piece is recorded.
What I'm doing here is taking all the data from the excavation boats that are actually digging and doing recovery work and bringing them into a charting program so we can see how the trail of the Atocha is developing. Each one of these colored circles represents an artifact. The purple, for example, is silver coins. The yellow dots, that's gold running up the trail. Blue, that's pottery, and green is iron artifacts. And it's kind of like following a trail of breadcrumbs through the forest.
I study these charts a lot. You'll find me at times just staring at the chart and your mind just starts thinking different theories and ideas. Maybe a chest of coins broke up and scattered through here. Or you could just look and see the yellow and see a trail of gold going this way. This trail is 8 miles long. That's about a couple years of work there. So it's a long process.
I really like seeing kids come through the museum and they get all excited when they see the treasure and they start asking questions about history that maybe they would never asked before.
There's all these magnificent items that are buried down there. Once we find them and bring them up, we can put them on display. People can enjoy them from now on.
Treasure recovery has changed quite a bit since I started. I still pursue the quest much like I did 40 years ago. I revel in going out into the field and in searching. Others tend to be more high-tech oriented. We have at our disposal these days a lot of technology, including sonar and precise metal detection. For what we look for, that is the buried treasure, the hidden caches, we found these tools not to be that useful to us.
Most of what we look for is hidden so well that metal detectors don't reach it.
It's basically the dogged work in the field, which is what we love.
And tie the animals to that tree over there, and then we can do the rest of it on foot.
For a young person interested in treasure hunting as a way of life, you have to understand that a great deal of this involves research. Probably 90% of any hunt involves research in the libraries, studying topographic maps, geologic maps, to try to get some feeling for what you're up against.
We have come to appreciate the history to the point where we chase down the history with the same energy that we chase down the treasure.
Treasure hunting is a rewarding hobby, very rewarding hobby, and just a lot of fun.
The most rewarding aspect is not the monetary reward. It's the healthy atmosphere. It's the camaraderie of other treasure hunters and learning about a lot of history. And that's why I love is the history.
Normally, you don't need a permit. If you are on private property, then you need to go to the people that own the property. But the beaches and the city parks and things, no, you can just go.
To a young beginner, you don't have to buy a very expensive metal detector. $99 will buy you a nice little start-out metal detector, and you can go out and find the same thing us experienced people find.
The biggest tip to anyone just starting this hobby is to be courteous. Do not dig holes, and don't leave a big mess. Good luck on your treasure hunt.